السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Please, if you hear my voice, let me know. ممتاز. Okay. Is a sedation like any other procedure you want to do? It need to be consented. And these are the regulation of Saudi Arabia, which of consent generally and sedation consent specific. So, a letter from Ministry of Health, Saudi informed consent guide, which will significantly contribute to preserving the patient and family rights and the practitioner as well as healthcare providers. So what is the informed consent? Informed consent is approval by the patient. Sometimes patient cannot approve, or his guardian or his representative to the health facility, to the hospital, or to the health practitioners, the surgeon, or the endoscopist, or whatever, performing all necessary procedures to maintain and recover the patient health. This is the result of this consent. So, components of informed consent: the consent itself, the consented, either the patient, his guardian, or his representative. Authorized for what? For the healthcare facility or the practitioner. What is the authorized action, the procedure required to maintain and regain health? Then the format. You indicate approval and consent in verbal or in written form. So what are the conditions of informed consent? Authorized person must fulfill the legal capacity. Procedure must be legitimate. Shall be in a language to be understood by the patient. Valid until the end of the specific medical procedure. And approval must be voluntary to the consent, not forced. And patient is fully aware and conscious. What are the conditions of medical practitioners? He must be, or she must be, qualified, licensed to practice and to provide the specific medical services, has a conscious sedation course, ACL, ACLS, or plus BCLS if needed. Aim for the benefit of the patient. Known healthcare standards of the medical profession, and shall not violate or exceed the boundaries of medical consent except in life-saving situations. So, what are the types of informed consent? Could be unrestricted or restricted. Unrestricted consent, it is the patient consent for the healthcare practitioner to perform medical procedure to preserve or recover their health. Restricted consent for the healthcare practitioner to perform a specific medical procedure to preserve his health. Both types are valid, whether it is unrestricted or restricted if the authorized procedure is legitimate. Types of informed consent: explicit verbal consent, which, for instance, the patient says to the practitioner, "I give you a consent to perform a certain surgical operation or certain examination." And in explicit consent, patient approves to perform a specific examination or intervention, but then the physician finds out that the cause of the illness is different compared to the cause of the medical procedure based on the consent that was given by the patient. However, the medical procedure must be restricted to achieve health purposes to cure the patient. Signal consent, when the patient nods their head as a sign of approval. Written consent when the patient writes his approval. Written informed consent shall be obtained in case of dangerous procedures with the risk of any side effects that may occur to the patient as follows. Any surgical operation, intervention, or hospital admission. Giving any type of anesthesia, general, regional, or sedation. Performing any interventional exam, or giving chemotherapy or radiotherapy. Taking photography of the patient. Either is it therapeutic or diagnostic for education, utilizing body parts and tissue that have been removed during operation, training during the internship year or before, with the required of a written informed consent, hemodialysis, blood transfusion, research, in case of compulsory admission for psychiatric patient, mental health care laws is followed. Anything indicating the approval of the patient is enough to obtain the consent to proceed with the medical procedure. However, this should be documented in the patient medical record. Patient silence shall not be considered a consent to perform any medical procedure. In case of conducting scientific research, medical research regulation and guidelines in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia shall be followed. Patients whose consent are deemed invalid, either minors below age of 18, unconscious patient, mentally incapacitated patient, patient with mental illness such as schizophrenia, mental disability, dementia, mentally retarded patient, moderate to severe, and patient with dementia. This is a guardian responsibility to give the consent. So, what is the guardian responsibility? Guardian of a minor is the father because of the relationship and near relative that cannot be detached. The guardian's order, based on the order of the legitimate guardianship and according to its provision, the father, then the grandfather, then mother, then closest male relative. Guardianship expiration when a minor reaches maturity above 18 age, 18 year of age, when unconscious person regains his consciousness and return to sanity and perception regarding those who suffer from illness that affect mental state and perception. In case where the guardian is absent or cannot be reached or cannot wait for his attendance, a committee is convened at the healthcare facility and authorized to give the consent on his behalf. Delegation and authorization of informed consent to the others. The patient can authorize somebody else to give a consent on his behalf. First, witnesses. Two witnesses should be testified. Second, essentially, informed consent is required except in the following cases: emergency cases, life-threatening cases, cases in which the public interest requires the need to treat or prevent, like contagious infectious diseases, or if the patient is having mental illness. Third, expiration of informed consent, which is 1 month, and fourth, child maturity. Some patients may need to obtain informed consent in a different way due to losing one or more of the conditions of the right informed consent that may require involving a third party to complete the procedure legally or to complete the medical procedure without the medical consent, such as informed consent regarding children under 18 years old. Written or oral approval must be taken from the guardian or representative who are under 15 years old, while who are 15 to 18 years old A written or oral approval must be taken from the patient and his guardian or his representative, except in the therapeutic intervention is necessary and cannot be postponed in order to achieve the physical and mental health interest of the patient in admission or compulsory treatment. In cases of a disease, life-threatening injuries, or fatal injury that may result in a loss of an organ or its function, it is permissible for the physician to ignore taking an informed consent under the following condition: patient's lack of capacity, absence of patient guardian or representative, with possibility of his condition getting worse, high potentialities of loss of an organ or its function, or even death, a consensus of at least two specialist physicians confirming the necessity of immediate medical intervention after examining the patient. Special cases. Saving lives and critical conditions. Medical or surgical intervention can be performed without the need for informed consent. However, it must be documented in the patient file and informing the patient or his relative upon their arrival about all procedure that had to be taken after the treatment. Pregnant patient. The informed consent is given by the pregnant patient herself. It is not allowable to ignore her. By the way, do not sedate pregnant. There is other team to do this. Usually anesthesia. Do not anesthetize or do conscious sedation for pregnant lady unless it is emergency and you are alone. She has the right to choose the person who will give the consent on her behalf, her father, brother, or husband. In cases of medical abortion and the mother's health is at risk, take consent from her personally or from her representative. If the reason for abortion is life-threatening, fetal abnormalities, the consent for both the mother and the father is required. Taking it by force. It is not allowed to force a patient or his relative to give informed consent if the patient has refused with full capacity. This is deemed as a violation of properly informed consent regulation. Deaf and dumb patients. The communication with is difficult. The medical team must provide a maximum effort to communicate with deaf and dumb patient, or have a translator, or bring a sign language specialist. And if this was impossible, consent can be given by a guardian or representative assigned by the patient himself. If there is no guardian or inability to get in touch with him, the health facility administration is required to contact the administrative governor to assign the patient representative and entitle the medical team to provide the minimum required treatment without the need of following the informed consent procedure. The most important part, medical consent documentation. It is the process in which the health practitioner or healthcare facility save the informed consent content and its procedures through writing, recording, or photography to return to them whenever needed. Informed consent documentation has two types. Legal documentation. This is the most important type of documentation. It combines both rules of testimony and codification. However, this system is governed by the medical institution and their legislative sphere and supervision. Customary and verbal documentation. The verbal work of the medical staff or their institution to document a routine medical procedure that shall be done once the patient enters the facility of the medical institution. And this may include laboratory tests, vaccination, or any other documentation work that doesn't require registration of the person who holds the documentation validity by the policies. The fingerprint electronic signature of the informed consent that is included in the electronic file is subjected to the Islamic law provision and the application law in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. In some healthcare facilities, he can sign with electronic fingerprint, or it can be done through signature in iPad, or still some hospitals they use the old version, which is paper based. As for the informed consent for patients without limbs or those similar to them, it is by visual recording or audiobook saved electronically in medical file with the legal documentation for that. What are the medical team mistakes during the discussion? Filling the informed consent form before meeting the patient. Frequent interruption of the patient. Failure to verify the patient identity. Giving wrong information to the patient. Failure to follow the ethical dialogue when discussing with the patient. Mistakes from the patient side. Failure to sign the refusal to carry out the medical procedure. Signing without reading the informed consent form. Hesitation of making the medical procedure to approve or refuse before having the committee opinion. Taking another information and patient experience in non-medical procedure. Medical team mistakes. Performing unnecessary medical procedure not included in the form signed by the patient. Failure to clarify the major and expected complication in cases the patient refused to do the medical procedure or to sign. Failure to ensure that the understanding of the patient or his guardian or representative to what was explained to them. Using medical terms or words that are not comprehensible to the patient. Asking to sign informed consent as a routine procedure. Common mistake in choosing a place, the existence of something that distracts or prevents the patient from understanding. The existence of something that violates the privacy of the patient during the process of explaining the medical procedure. The presence of people or relatives that the patient does not want them to know about his condition. Thank you very much. I know this subject is a bit dull and difficult to understand, but you have to know that documentation is two parts: pre-assessment, intraoperative or intra-procedural, and post-procedural plus informed consent. Informed consent, you have to make the patient understand what are you going to consent him for, and this sedation, there will be a sedation process, and what is the complication from the procedure from the surgical side, and the most common complication from sedation process itself. Make sure that alternative benefits and risks are discussed with the patient and signed. Thank you very much. Soon we will start another lecture, just 2 minutes. Now we will talk about how to deal with problems. Problems regarding sedation. Okay. Complications are inevitable, even with most experienced doctors. These complications could range from minor to catastrophic. And it is a statistics and sometimes it has to happen. So, what are the complications of procedural anesthesia or sedation? It could happen either intraoperative or postoperative. Intraoperative will be either due to induction of sedation, maintenance of sedation, or could be due to laryngoscopy or management of the airway itself. Either laryngoscopy intratracheal intubation. So we will know what are the complications of laryngoscopy if you needed to, or airway management at all. Trauma to lips, teeth, tongue, tonsillar bellars, epiglottis, vocal cord. Let's see epiglottis and vocal cord, especially for laryngoscopy. The above, it could be due to using airway adjuncts, lips and teeth and tongue could be due to bag mask ventilation. Complication of endotracheal intubation. Injury to vocal cord could happen. Injury to trachea could happen. Blockade of a tube by secretion, blood clot, foreign body, bronchospasm could happen. In induction, patient might have hypotension or hypertension. Hypotension could be induced from sedation medication, or hypertension could be due to the diagnostic or the treatment, or sometimes from intubation or manipulation of the airway. Sometimes arrhythmia, bradycardia, tachycardia, systemic vas sorry, supraventricular tachycardia arrest could happen, but it's rare unless the patient is in bad condition and he was not sedated or anesthetized properly. Hypoventilation, upper airway obstruction, this is after sedation. During, once you start sedation, patient might obstruct their airway. So hypoventilation will happen, then hypoxia will happen. Sometimes histamine release, which will lead to bronchospasm or anaphylaxis. Regurgitation, most common. Regurgitation, aspiration. Mendelssohn syndrome is very rare, especially in pregnant lady, but regurgitation could happen and aspiration or partial aspiration could happen. So we have to know that before any sedation, there should be a fasting time. Even though some patients with fasting time, they are prone to aspiration or regurgitation, especially patients with sympathetic stimulation, like if they are in pain or they are diabetic. hypothermia and hyperthermia could happen as well. Hypoglycemia, hyperglycemia. Hypothermia, induction of anesthesia or sedation, or the procedure itself, or irrigation, or the procedure place could cause a hypothermia to the patient. When you give a patient sedation, he will not be able to maintain his normothermia. So hypothermia and hyperthermia. Hyperthermia may be a cause of malignant hyperthermia, which is rare. Room is with high temperature, covered with, he is febrile, covered with drapes. So it's better to always have a temperature beside, temperature checking beside ECG, blood pressure, saturation. Hypoglycemia and hyperglycemia. Hypoglycemia, pediatric patient, they might go on hypoglycemia. Patient with long fasting time, they might go to hypoglycemia. The same thing, patient with diabetes, they will go on hyperglycemia if they are given too much fluid or given D5 if it's not regulated. They might have a low or high fluid infusion if the patient is fasting and he has IV cannula and he has his own maintenance over the night. No need to give a patient too much fluid. Electrolytes imbalance in the procedure, it's very rare. But in general, anesthesia, long time, it might happen. Blood loss or anemia, it's possible. But in a situation of sedation, most procedures, they are from 1 hour and less than 1 hour. So blood loss and anemia is very rare. Accidental kinking or disconnection of airway. Disconnection of oxygen, disconnection of mask, disconnection of nasal cannula, or disconnection of the tube itself, or kinking of the circuit. This could happen. Will lead hypoventilation and hypoxia. Thyroid crisis and hypothyroidism in patient with endocrine problem. It's very rare. Coronary ischemia and heart failure and MI. This is common. Common if the blood pressure and heart rate is not controlled well. Chronic ischemia in susceptible patient might happen. Embolism, fat, air, amniotic, maybe. Fat, especially in plastic surgery, it's possible. Air embolism, it could happen for a procedure for getting central venous access. So, post-operative complication, if you manage the airway, or in sedation in general, confusion and cognitive decline, sore throat if you manipulate the airway, chills and shivering, either because of the medication or because of the temperature of the environment, nausea and vomiting, especially in patient with history of nausea and vomiting post-sedation. Muscle pain is very rare with certain medication. If there is a persistent apnea, the cause could be sedation overdose, residual muscle relaxant, which was not used in sedation, post-extubation laryngospasm or bronchospasm, this could happen, or obstruction, hypoxia or hypercarbia due to obstruction or hypoventilation, delayed recovery due to patient medical condition or due to overdose of sedation, regurgitation or aspiration, possible. Hypothermia, shivering, patient could be covered or could be giving some medication to cease shivering. Post-operative nausea and vomiting, it happens in 20 to 30% at recovery time. Hoarseness of voice if there is manipulation of airway, sore throat if there is endoscopy or manipulation of the airway, atelectasis for the patient who has obstruction or patient smokers or increase intra-abdominal pressure or any abdominal procedure. Tracheitis is very rare. Tracheal stenosis is very rare. Halothane-induced hepatitis, halothane is out of favor, is not used anymore. Complication of positioning. The most common complication of positioning is nerve injury. Regional and general anesthesia abolish protective reflexes and predispose patient to injury. Most common in lower limb, peroneal nerve, upper limb, ulnar nerve, sometimes radial and brachial plexus if there is lateral lateral position procedure. Any position, lithotomy, lateral decubitus. Patient with contracture, positioned before induction of anesthesia. Final positioning should be evaluated before draping. Sensory or motor dysfunction, usually temporary. If there is sensory or motor dysfunction, this is usually transient, from 2 to 12 weeks. Nerve conduction or EMG are indicated to document wherever the damage is new or chronic. Nerve conduction study and EMG can be used to know. So positioning, sitting prone and reverse Lindenberg, they might have venous air embolism. Lithotomy, extremity compartment syndrome, or common peroneal nerve injury. Prone sitting, retinal ischemia or retinal detachment, or eye injury. Corneal abrasion, backache, alopecia, and sometimes in supine lithotomy to Lindenberg. Skin necrosis could happen as well. Awareness. Yeah, awareness is very important subject. Awareness in sedation and in anesthesia. Risk factors. Light level of anesthesia. Hypovolemic. Injured or RTA. Obstetric patient. They are the high risk for awareness of anesthesia. Prior history of awareness. Cardiac procedure in shocked patient. Because in shocked patient, in those type of the patient, any sedation or any anesthesia given, it will affect their cardiac function. So in this case, we don't give too much, or sometimes we don't reach the optimum dose or the MAC. So because they are hypovolemic, they will be prone for more hypovolemia. They are injured. We don't want to increase their intracranial pressure, or obstetric patient, because we don't want these medications to go to the baby who has already prior history of awareness. They might have another history of awareness. And cardiac patient in shocked state, more sedation means more shocked state. So in these kind of patients, we don't give them the optimum amount of anesthesia to preserve their heart function. Usually chronic pain patient, because they are familiar with all sedation and pain management medication, or medication errors, or hypernatremia. Human errors that may lead to preventable anesthetic accident. Unrecognized breathing circuit disconnection, mistaking drug administration, or airway mismanagement. Anesthesia machine error or misuse, fluid mismanagement, intravenous line disconnection. Sometimes the cannula you are using for conscious sedation is tissued or blocked. The workstation of giving oxygen or gas could be faulty, or there is disconnection. Thank you very much. If you have a question, let me know. How can we deal with regurgitation or vomiting? First, you put the patient in recovery position. You put the patient in recovery position. Head down. Put the patient head down. Use one suction or two suction. Abort the procedure. Abort sedation. C, if you need to give oxygen, if saturation goes down, call for help. Clear? Again, patient head down. Put the patient in recovery position. Suction, provide oxygen, and call for help. You know, attempts are arbitrary. Some will say two, some will say three. If you are able, if you are expert, you are allowed to do or two or three. But if you are not trained well, or you have a problem, or you need help, please do not make more attempts to do. Attempts of intubation because any laryngoscopy or any maneuver to airway, it will lead to airway edema and it will complicate things. Well, regarding fasting, fasting is clear fluids 2 hours, milk 4 to 6 hours, fatty food 8 hours. There is a guideline for fasting. Please refer to guideline. Any more questions, please? Okay, now we will talked about how to take the consent. We talked about the problems that might happen during sedation, and we will talk how do you discharge patient after sedation. Usually, we use in very detailed and in anesthesia department very detailed Albert score system. I will give you a hint about how what the important things that you need to know before you discharge him from the procedural area. So recovery from sedation or anesthesia can range from completely uncomplicated to life-threatening and must be managed by skilled medical personnel and nurse. Let's have some history of recovery. Methods of anesthesia have been available for more than 160 years. The recovery has only been common for the past 50 years. In the 1920s and 30s, several post-anesthesia care units opened in the US and abroad. And in 1949, recovery was considered a standard of care. What are the staffing of recovery? 1-to-1 nurse in the first 15 minutes after procedure, after anesthesia. Then one nurse for every two patients after the first 15 minutes. The anesthesiologist responsible for the surgical anesthetic remain responsible for the managing the patient in the post-anesthesia care unit. Location. Recovery should be located close to the operating suite. Immediate access to X-ray department, blood bank, blood gas, and labs. Every room or operating room should have 1.5 bed of recovery. An open ward is optimal for patient observation with at least one isolation room. It should have central nursing station, piped in oxygen, air, and vacuum for suction. What are the important equipments in recovery area? Automated blood pressure, saturation of oxygen, ECG, and IV support should be located at each bed. Suction and oxygen flow meter at each bedside. Suction for like suctioning the airway or patient regurgitation, oxygen to supplement. Capabilities of arterial and central venous pressure monitoring, supply of immediately available emergency equipment, flash cart, and defibrillator. So what are the admission reports? Preoperative history, you have to endorse to the nurse the preoperative history, intraoperative factors, what kind of a procedure, what type of sedation or anesthesia, estimated blood loss if it had happened, what is the estimated urine output, then assessment and report of the current status of the patient, then postoperative instruction. So what the nurse should do if the patient leaves recovery, or what the patient needs to know if he leaves one daycare section. What are the post-operative pain management? First, simple analgesia, paracetamol, and non-steroidal anti-inflammatory medications, or IM or intravenous opioids, or oral opioids. If there is anxiety, you can give midazolam, but it's not preferable, especially at the end of the procedure. Some might need epidural, some might need regional analgesic blocks. Some patients should go with patient-controlled analgesia or patient-controlled epidural analgesia. Discharge from recovery. there is two discharge score. One is the old Albert, and the other is Boston Anesthesia Discharge Scoring System. Albert's score is simple sum of numerical values assigned to activity. Patient is active. Respiration, breathing, circulation, consciousness, and oxygen saturation. The other one is a modified Albert score, which also includes assessment of pain, nausea and vomiting, surgical bleeding, vital signs, and activity. A score of 9 or 10 shows readiness to leave recovery. So how do you count? How do you take the score? Let's say in activity section, patient moves all extremities voluntarily on a command. You ask him to move his hand, he moves it. You ask him to open his eyes, he opens his eyes. This is two. Respiration. If he breathes deeply and coughs freely, this is two. So now we have four. Circulation. Blood pressure is normal or more than or plus 2 millimeter mercury of pre-anesthetic level. This is two. Fully awake, communicating, this is two. Saturation is more than 92%, this is two. So we have 10. He's ready to leave. On the other hand, if he's unable to move, this is zero. If he's not breathing, this is zero. If his blood pressure is lower than pre-anesthetic level, 50 meter mercury, this is zero. If he's not responding, this is zero. If saturation is below 92 with oxygen supplement, this is zero. So he has, you have to summon somebody to help you and he is not ready to leave. Okay? The other one, which is added or the modified Albert score system, vital signs, blood pressure, and pulse. 2 points if blood pressure and pulse is within 20% of preoperative baseline, or he has steady gait, no dizziness, minimal nausea and vomiting, it can be treated with oral with oral meds or IV medication. Pain is acceptable. Controlled by the patient, controlled with IV or oral medication. There is minimal surgical breathing. No dressing changes required. So all these are two, so we have 10. But zero if more than 40% of preoperative baseline of vital signs or unable to ambulate, or you need to give him continuous medication to improve vomiting and nausea, or his score is 10 out of 10 or 9 out of 10 of pain, or the bleeding is severe, or vital signs keep deteriorating. So he's not for discharge. Now you have a clue about what kind of things that we evaluate before asking the patient or asking the nurse or the ward to come and take the patient outside the area which you did sedation or anesthesia for the patient. So what are the standards? All patients who have received general anesthesia, regional anesthesia, or monitored anesthesia care should receive post-anesthesia management. Patients should be transported to recovery by a member of anesthesia care team that is upon arrival, the patient should be re-evaluated and verbal report should be provided to the nurse. The patient shall be evaluated continually in the recovery, every 5 minutes, every 10 minutes, every 15 minutes, every half an hour, then to be discharged. A physician is responsible for discharging the patient in case of OR. So, nausea and vomiting, most common complication recovery. Could happen due to either hypoxia, hypotension, pain, anxiety, chemotherapy, GIT obstruction, narcotics, volatile anesthetics, induction medication or due to vagal response. Could be due to pregnancy, increase intracranial pressure. So how do you fix it? You give fluids, IV fluids, medication like Zofran, Phenergan, Promethazine. All they are anti-emetic and dexamethasone as well. Respiratory complication. Nearly two-thirds of major anesthesia-related incidents may be respiratory. Airway obstruction, which will lead to hypoxemia, either low inspired concentration of oxygen or hypoventilation. So assess the patient vital signs and respiratory rate, evaluate the airway patency, rule out obstruction or foreign body, mask ventilate. Before you mask ventilate, provide oxygen, mask ventilate if needed, intubate and secure the airway if needed, if you couldn't call for help. Failure to regain consciousness. Either it's a preoperative intoxication, residual anesthetic, IV, or inhaled, profound neuromuscular blockade, profound hypothermia, electrolyte abnormalities, or thromboembolic cardiovascular accident, or after seizure. Oh, myocardial ischemia. So increased risk in the patient who has history of coronary artery disease, congestive heart failure, smokers, hypertensives, tachycardia patient, severe hypoxemia, or patient with anemia. Treatment, oxygen, aspirin, nitroglycerin if needed, and morphine if needed. This can be done by, usually it should done, it has been done by ER patients, or you can summon cardiologist if you. You need to apply 12-lead ECG, take a history, consult cardiology. Fever, causes of fever, either infections, drug or blood reaction, we did transfusion of blood, there is transfusion reaction, tissue damage, neoplastic disorder, metabolic disorder, thyroid storm, adrenal crisis, pheochromocytoma, malignant hyperthermia, neuroleptic malignant syndrome, acute porphyria, sepsis. Thank you very much. Please let me know if you have any questions.
Thank you, Dr. Rabah. Inshallah. Any one of the colleagues if has any question? After lecture of Dr. Rabah, inshallah, we'll go to break for 15 minutes, then come back again.
Okay.
Any question for Dr. Rabah? Thank you, Dr. Rabah, for your efforts. Excellent presentation. Thank you very much. We'll go to break now and we'll join again at 5:15 after 15 minutes. Thank you, everyone. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الصوت واضح يا جماعة والصورة واضحة؟ نبدأ بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Today I will start my topic. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم مع دكتور محمد نصير consultant anesthesia high cluster about pediatric sedation and some hint about COVID era. Okay. We have yesterday full lectures about the adult sedation and today Dr. Rabah speaks with us about the recovery and the mishaps, airway management, and also adult population. This lecture about the concept of pediatric, because a lot of us face pediatric in his practice, in maternity hospitals, in pediatric centers, as a part of a population. Children are a population who have been spared the significant burden of severe illness during COVID era. During COVID-19, finding in pediatric patients noted that boys are more commonly affected than girls and mostly asymptomatic or mildly symptomatic. While children age younger than 3 years and those with congenital heart disease seems to be disproportionately impacted by this load of COVID-19. What is the objective of this lecture? To distinguish risk factors for coronavirus 2019 related morbidity and mortality and identify modes of transmission. I want to state appropriate infection control measures to reduce transmission and describe measures to reduce the risk of infection spread, mitigate adverse health effects in higher risk children, and to promote general health through preventive care. To reduce the nosocomial transmission of viral infection, we adopt policies and procedures. During policies, we need to do effective triage of arriving patients and the initiation of contact and or droplet precautions, infection control measures spanning arrival to discharge, and should prioritize of PPE distribution and use, limitation of visitors, assign COVID recovered workers to COVID cohorts, protection of high-risk workers. By procedures, we need to limit aerosol generating procedures and promote individual or cohort isolation. We should use negative pressure rooms when available, suction with closed circuit systems and viral filters. We should limit room re-entry and practice scrupulous hand hygiene. What about procedural sedation and analgesia in pediatrics? Pediatric procedural sedation and analgesia has grown significantly and occur in emergency room, procedural suites, radiology, dental office, and non-operating room areas by providers with varying level of training and expertise. Children receive sedation for this intervention are often less able to tolerate some procedures or imaging studies than adults. So, procedural sedation in pediatrics is not limited to major painful procedures requiring deeper level of sedation. There is common procedures such as IV cannulation, VD puncture, urethral catheterization, and lumbar puncture can be associated with significant stress or pain in pediatric patients. The majority of pediatric patients who receive procedural sedation and analgesia are not cared for by anesthesiologist or registered nurse. While serious adverse events in procedural sedation and analgesia are rare when the sedation is provided by trained sedation team. A recent review from the Pediatric Sedation Research Consortium reported a serious adverse events rate at 1.78%, very low, with upper airway obstruction being the most common. This picture shows us an example of hypertrophied inflamed tonsils, which is a common disease in pediatric population. This narrow airway by the hypertrophied tonsils lead to airway obstruction. Again, we should consider safety. Unfortunately, serious critical events, including death, have occurred during sedation. It's rare, but it happened. This adverse outcome were likely avoidable with the standard safety measures being used. Please always search for safety. Pediatric procedural sedation analgesia refers to techniques and indications used to minimize anxiety and pain associated with unpleasant or painful procedures. Procedural sedation analgesia in pediatric is used when painful or uncomfortable procedures are unavoidable and incorporates physical, psychological, and pharmacological interventions to minimize discomfort. Actually, deprivation from parents actually is very stressful for young child. Procedural sedation analgesia can be performed skillfully in various settings and is not exclusively practiced by anesthesia practitioner, but is now practiced routinely by other specialties such as emergency and critical care clinicians, along with several nurse specialists. Sedation represents a continuum from wakefulness to general anesthesia, as shown in this pyramid, okay, with different level of sedation from minimal, moderate, deep up to GA, and it is exchangeable, which is the concept of continuum. So procedural sedation is practiced on a continuum using interventions to provide the optimal amount of sedation and analgesia for the procedure that need to be performed. This can vary from anesthesiologists for imaging or minor non-painful procedures to moderate sedation for more painful procedures such as fracture reduction. What are goals of procedural sedation and analgesia? The most important goal is to keep the patient safe during and after the procedure. Additional goals include behavioral modification, increased procedural compliance, reduction of fear and anxiety, management of discomfort and pain. Also, there may be times when maximizing amnesia and minimizing psychological trauma are also important. Levels of sedation and monitored anesthesia care. Different evaluation methods have been developed to define the degree of sedation, like RAMSI score, we discussed it yesterday. Traditional sedation definitions were written for adults and are dependent on the patient's ability to respond verbally or purposefully. Mild or moderate sedation is challenging and often not successful in younger patients. And if we need to assess the level of sedation in pediatrics, we should be familiar and trained in the level of communication of this baby. If we are dealing with a baby and 2 years old, he cannot express complete sentences. If you are dealing with a child 8 years old or 6 years old, you should use phrases acceptable and easily understood by him. The most commonly used is the RAMSI score. That is scored on 8 characteristics, started from 0 to 8, and exercises start from level 2 to 3, while moderate sedation from 4 to 5, deep sedation at 6, and general anesthesia from 7 to 8. Our target is usually from 3 to 4, and again, children under age of 6 frequently need deep sedation for procedures, In these circumstances, general anesthesia may be safer, faster, and more cost effective. So I recommend in young babies, like 3 years, 4 years old, if there is a lengthy procedure, if the stress of the baby is expected to be high, please consult and keep in touch with an assist. If issue is imaging for a minor procedure, less than 10 minutes, 5 minutes, and you are skillful in the BALS, skillful in the airway management and the medications, you can go proceed. Again, we revise the definition of minimal sedation, or also called anoxiolysis, where patient is awake and relaxed, able to respond normally to verbal stimuli with competent and patent airway. There is no any hemodynamic challenges in this situation. While moderate sedation, also called conscious sedation before, now we as a target of procedural sedation now, the patient has a depressed level of consciousness, able to respond purposefully to verbal stimuli alone or combined by tactile stimuli. The airway remain intact and no intervention to maintain the airway patency or hemodynamic compromise. Deep level of sedation, the patient has a depressed level of consciousness, cannot be easily aroused, but does respond purposefully following repeated or painful stimuli. Patient may need support to maintain patent airway. In the case of dissociative, the patient is in a trance-like state wherein they are unaware of the pain and amnesic to the event, but remain awake with intact respiration, airway reflexes, and cardiopulmonary stability. In general anesthesia, patient has a loss of consciousness. He is not arousable even to painful stimuli. The patient has an impaired ability to maintain independent ventilatory function and often need assistance to maintain patency of airway and ventilation with boost pressure from ventilation, and may need some support to hemodynamics. Take care, there is alarm. Pediatric patients are at high risk of unintentional moving to deeper state of sedation than desired in the concept of continuum. So the provider must have the sufficient airway management skills and be a pediatric advanced life support certified to perform procedural sedation and analgesia. Again, anyone should go to sedation in pediatrics or even in adults, he should be skillful enough to keep the bare airway patent and to keep the ventilation optimum. He should be BLS and ACLS or BALS in pediatrics certified and well trained. What is the difference between moderate sedation versus monitored anesthesia care? In the traditional obsolete sedation model, the responsible physician may assume the dual role of performing the procedure and supervising the sedation, implying a single provider model. Now, the monitored anesthesia care includes the pre-procedural anesthesia assessment, along with managing the patient's actually anticipated physiological derangement during the procedure. It is a two-provider model and is mandatory in monitored anesthesia care to be provided by a separate anesthesia provider. How to provide a successful sedation program? The successful sedation program should include a sedation committee, which oversees training, credentials, and the skills maintenance of the providers performing sedation. Quality improvement process and the critical incident reviews should be in place to evaluate, assess, and improve this process. To summarize this important task, you cannot have a license or a certificate about completion of the training of procedural sedation, and you only provide give this service once per month or twice per month. No, you cannot be a competent candidate to do safe practice for procedural sedation. So we should have a sedation committee in the hospital or an institute to revise the rate of every trainee and how many times he provides this service to people and to follow the competency of the staff. Pre-sedation assessment. There is medical assessment and focused physical exam. We should ask about past medical history, current comorbidities, and surgical problems. We should ask about respiratory, recent upper respiratory tract infections, history of snoring, disordered sleep or sleep apnea. We should ask about cardiac congenital heart disease or arrhythmias. Now speaking in pediatrics population group, gastrointestinal like delayed gastric emptying or severe gastroesophageal reflux disease, other systemics like genetic disorders, morbid obesity, major endocrine disorders, the personal and family history of sedation or anesthesia problems, including adverse reaction, should be assessed as well as the patient's psychological and developmental status. A comprehensive preoperative assessment should be done. According to physical examination, we should focus on airway abnormalities, including evaluation for possible airway obstruction, like tonsillar hypertrophy, macroglossi, difficult intubation during congenital problem like micro retrognathia, limitation in mouth opening, or other craniofacial abnormalities that may make mask ventilation difficult. Take care of this careful consideration. It is highly recommended to consult an anesthesia service before performing procedural sedation, as we mentioned before, in ASA 3 or ASA 4, also in young babies less than 4 years age or 5 years age, according to training level of the practitioner in the hospital. Patients with a history of obstructive sleep apnea, obesity, myopathy, or syndromic like trisomy 21 Down syndrome should be carefully evaluated prior to undergoing sedation. They may have increased sensitivity to medications or prolonged recovery times requiring admission for observation and for recovery to baseline status after sedation. This is very important. Obstructive sleep apnea is not rare in pediatrics, specifically in syndromic babies or myopathy or like this. So detection and assessment is crucial for safety and close monitoring to full recovery. And the better if you suspect about these cases to refer to an assist. Extra considerations should be given to young age, history of prematurity, airway malformations, developmental problems, and patients at risk of aspiration. About that, the issue of fasting hours. Two pediatric anesthesia societies, like European Anesthesia Society, support allowing the children to take clear fluids up to 1 hour before general anesthesia. But this change has not been implemented in the American Society of Anesthesiology fasting guidelines due to insufficient evidence to support the safety or harm of clear fluids for 1 hour versus 2 hours before procedures. Current recommendations regarding fasting for elective sedation cases are based on the ASA guidelines, and it is mandatory to keep fasting at least 2 hours for clear fluids and for milk or turbid fluids from 4 to 6 hours. In fatty meals, up to 8 hours. In traditional meals, it's 6 hours is enough. As pediatrics easily go to starvation or go to loss of their fluids, we minimize the fasting hour in pediatrics only to 2 or 4 hours for fluids. Okay. Remember again, never say never that pediatrics are small adults. There is a big difference between physiology of pediatrics and the physiology of adults. We cannot deal with pediatrics as a small adult. Why? Because the cardiac function of the maturity of the cardiac system is not like the adults. The maturity of the diaphragm, the maturity of respiratory muscles, the maturity of the alveoli, not like the adults. Actually, we have developmental changes that put the pediatric at his situation in triuterine or in unit phase or after that in the toddler's age. To keep him to go to the adult level, it takes about more than 12 years. This is why in our policies, we define the adult more than 12 or 14 years age, okay? Because there is physiological changes from adults to pediatrics. For example, the water compartment in pediatrics is much higher than the adult. So if we are giving a drug which has a high liability or solubility for water, the doses and range of doses will be different from adults, okay? The maturity of the diaphragm and the intercostal muscles. In adults, it is our diaphragm has higher susceptibility to maintain spontaneous breathing and like this. In pediatrics, if the baby is crying, he will go to cyanosis even without pathology. And especially in the new needs, I'm speaking about new needs, okay? But there is a change in the physiology, in the respiratory system, in the musculoskeletal system, in cardiac system, and this is applied and interpreted clinically to the dose and the frequency of doses and like this. Actually, also there is a changes in the anatomy of the airway. There is a challenge in the developmental airway from pediatric to adults also, okay? For example, pediatric airway easily go to edema, and if there is many trials to intubate a pediatric, easily go to airway obstruction by massive airway edema. not like adult can also go, but after much, much more trials. Okay. Again, for fasting criteria, regurgitation and pulmonary inspiration are rare events. However, sedative agents may impair protective airway reflexes. This is why the American College of Emergency Physicians and the International Committee for Advancement of Procedural Sedation Guidelines support less restrictive fasting policies for brief and urgent procedures, as they report a low incidence pulmonary aspiration with variable fasting times. Okay, and actually, if the patient is not fulfilling all the times of aspiration of fasting, and there is high risk for aspiration, please call for help from an assistant. What about personnel and equipment? It is critically important to use the two provider model, monitored anesthesia care model, where patient sedation and monitoring is provided by a person separate from the proceduralist. Okay, procedural sedation provider should be credentialed in obstetric and positive life support, trained in airway management and vascular access, recognize and rescue an obstructed airway, and provide positive pressure ventilation, able to perform invasive airway techniques, including intubation. Maintenance of skills for both rare and the common issues are important to practice the either simulation or working in an operating room to refresh the practice. A dedicated pediatric sedation cart should be stocked and maintained with airway monitoring, vascular access equipment for patients of all ages and sizes. Use of emergency checklist is recommended and should be available wherever sedation is provided. If local anesthesia is administered, medications for treatment of local anesthetic toxicity should be also available, and the actual chart for management of local anesthetic systemic toxicity. This is, for example, different size of tubes, endotracheal tubes, and according to age and body weight, different size of laryngeal mask airway, different age according to age and body weight, body surface area, the caudal airway, oropharyngeal airway with different sizes, the IV cannula with different size gauges, and according to the situation and the need for wide bore cannula or not. Monitoring. Pre-procedural vital signs should be obtained and post-procedural monitoring done until the patient is ready for discharge. Monitoring should include oxygenation, ventilation, and circulation, including a pulse oximetry, continuous ECG with blood pressure and heart rate monitoring every 5 minutes or 3 to 5 minutes in the procedures, and after recovery, till recovery of the consciousness, and then after every 15 minutes till discharge. Again, the use of exhaled carbon dioxide for deep sedation and should be strongly considered for moderate sedation by capnography. Again, we have available in Masimo machines, and actually it's available in the MOH, we have a nasal cannula with sampling chamber for spontaneous ventilation capnography. Okay, capnography actually is a traditional one, is connected to the endotracheal tube, but there is also available some modules connected to the nasal cannula. It's available in ICU, it's available in the OR, should be available in the ER also, and anywhere we are giving sedation. Again, the pretracheal pericardial stethoscope has recently found renewed vigor when used in conjunction with capnography by increasing the ability to identify adverse respiratory events. Monitoring should be also checked regularly, okay? Monitoring should also include clinical signs of the depth of sedation and evaluation of pain and stress. Sedation scales like RAMSI or Michigan sedation scale, we are using RAMSI most commonly. Additional tools for monitoring like EEG or bispectral index and by sideline or bispectral index can be used. Processed EEG is not reliable in children under sedation as it is for general anesthesia. Some commonly given sedation medications such as ketamine or dexmedetomidine can also alter the bispectral index. So it is not used routinely for sedation procedural sedation. This is used mainly in deep level of sedation or in GA. But the classical monitoring, according to American Society of Anesthesiology, blood pressure, invisible blood pressure, non-invisible pressure, ECG, pulse oximetry, and capnography. Don't forget. Don't forget documentation and the consent. Prior to sedation, written consent should be obtained and documented. Patient and the parent guardian should be given information regarding the risk, benefit, and alternatives. The child should be provided environmentally appropriate information. You should speak to the child, not only to his parents, in an adequate, suitable words to him. The discussion should include possibility of sedation failure and the options if the child is unable to complete the procedure according to local and institutional requirements up to consent for GA. Documentation should be standardized, electronic or paper based. Actually, now most of our hospital and KSA is electronic. Pre-sedation assessment of the patient, sedation record, including monitoring data, time, and dosage of all medications or inhaled gases, any adverse events, and the post-procedural recovery record. This document should be available for future sedation procedure or anesthesia for review. A quality improvement process which evaluates sedation failure or adverse events should be incorporated to improve the institutional system, patient care, and safety. Medications. Most sedation was administered by nurses and directed by non-anesthesiologists using medications such as bentobarbital, chlorhydrate, fentanyl, and midazolam. Newer medications seem to have shorter half-life, but may provide an increased depth of sedation. Serious adverse events due to concurrent use of multiple sedatives, particularly when there is any of the following, three or more medications used. If we are using nitrous oxide in combination with other sedatives, and the medication is long half-life. Provider giving cis sedation should have a thorough understanding of sedative pharmacodynamics, pharmacokinetics, and interactions, and we should able to detect the continuum of sedation and the easy to detect the airway obstruction and give the sufficient support to dynamics and the airway till recovery from the sedative effect. What is the ideal agent for procedural sedation? It should have a sedative, analgesic, and amnetic properties with rapid onset, short duration of action, safe and quick recovery, and for discharge. Also, procedural sedation analgesia is usually the result of combining a short-acting benzodiazepine such as midazolam, which is a sedative, amnesic, and anxiolytic properties, but have no analgesic properties. Midazolam is not analgesic at all. Okay, we combine the use of this midazolam with an opioid such as fentanyl. Several drugs are also options alone or in combination. The combination of midazolam and fentanyl is one of the most adopted procedures to carry out procedural sedation analgesia, but other combinations like fentanyl with propofol or propofol plus ketamine are also adopted, but we recommend in this course that we should be familiar with fentanyl, midazolam, or midazolam to be familiar with these drugs to give a safe practice of sedation. Propofol needs a high experience in the doses and pharmacology, and also how to keep the airway patent because propofol easily go with the patient to apnea. Okay, ketamine is a common drug we are using. Also, somehow it's not compromising the airway in the normal usual doses, but ketamine lead to his hallucinations and increase the salivation. It leads to some tachycardia. Also, ketamine can be used, but it should be also you should be also familiar with fentanyl and midazolam with other adjuncts. Other additives like local anesthetic infiltration like this. I will go briefly about the medications. As regards midazolam, the dose range of from 2 to 0.5 milligram in adults. Okay, in pediatrics, we are starting with 0.2, 0.1 milligram per kg. Okay, it takes about from 2 to 3 minutes to reach the full efficacy. The elevation half-life is 1.5 hours. Midazolam should be prepared as 1 milligram in 1 ml solution, especially in children less than 15 kilograms of body weight. And midazolam solution with concentration higher than 1 milligram are not recommended at all. Also, again, our concept, calculate your dose and start by low dose, then give the time, wait till it reaches the circulation, like assess the patient again and close monitor the patient, and then titrate up by another dose, and then wait again, then the effect can be reached, or titrate and wait and keep eye on patient monitor. Bentobarbital is taken orally as from 3 to 5 milligrams per kg. It takes 30 minutes to work. Its duration is variable. This is not recommended to give oral sedatives. There is no analgesia at all, and it has long recovery times. Nitrous oxide, it's an inhaled gas. We start with 100% oxygen and increase concentration of nitrous oxide to the effect. Maximum we reach to 70% nitrous oxide and 30% of oxygen. It is very rapid to reach the peak effect of 30 seconds. But there is an issue of second gas effect or hypoxia, prolonged hypoxia after use of nitrous oxide. It is a good amnesic drug. It is give us a state of dissociation. Can be used in dentistry. Can be used during even in pediatrics and dentistry or minor procedures. Should be not given in bowel obstruction. Shouldn't be given during if there is suspicious of pneumothorax or increased intracranial tension. It is a nauseating drug. It's contraindicated in pregnancy also. Okay, but actually, if you applying nitrous oxide, our colleagues in dentistry they commonly use it as Entonox. Don't forget to supply your patient with pure oxygen after discontinuation of nitrous oxide. For fentanyl, fentanyl is actually an opioid. Also, it may have some sedative effect. It has wide range of doses. Start from 0.5 mics per kg up to 5 mics per kg in cardiac surgical cases, for example. It can be given intranasally, it can be given IV. Also, I recommend the IV route. It takes maximum 5 to 10 minutes to reach the onset. Actually, duration of fentanyl, not only 20 minutes, it's cumulative because it's high lipid profile, high lipid solubility. It is a potent, very potent analgesic. If you are dealing with patient with suspected pain, for example, bone marrow aspiration or imaging guided biopsies, it is recommended to use fentanyl. Ketamine also has a sedative, analgesic, and anesthetic effect. Ketamine is one of the anesthetics. It's the only can, as anesthetic have some analgesic properties. But the issue of the ketamine, the salivation, excessive salivation, and hallucination boost procedure, okay? But it is actually commonly used. Dexmedetomidine is a good drug with some alpha-2 agonist activity, but it has a compromise in the hemodynamics and bradycardia. Actually, I cannot recommend it in pediatrics or in day case situations. Propofol, again, propofol is recommended only for expertise to deal with the airway, to deal with hypotension. It has range from 1 to 2 milligram per kg. We should divide the dose again and give titration of the doses. It is rapid onset drug. It's anti-emetic. Pattern of recovery of propofol is good. If given repeatedly, the recovery will be somewhat delayed. If you use propofol, you should be aware about maintenance of airway and back mask ventilation to correct the apnea, and be careful about the hemodynamic instability, especially in a hypovolemic or shock state. Etomidate, another drug, can be used for anesthesia. It is not analgesic at all. Also, propofol, not analgesic at all. Etomidate only has a property to have hemodynamic stability and hemodynamic in shock state patients. It's a good odd choice. It has a problem in adrenocortical insufficiency. Okay, ketamine, again, is a good drug even for major procedures. It can be taken IM. In some situations, you can give it oral easily. It has some respiratory and cardiovascular stabilities. Not a good option in ischemic heart disease patients like this. The risk of airway obstruction, apnea, and laryngeal spasm is higher in infants less than 3 months age. So patient age under 3 months is not a good indication, okay? Midazolam co-administration doesn't reduce the risk of emergence agitation also. Combination of propofol and ketamine, you have the benefit of ketamine for maintenance of airway and the maintenance of ventilation. Have the probability of propofol for rapid onset and rapid offset. Actually, this combination also used in some situations like GI endoscopies, gastrointestinal endoscopies like this. Also, I not recommend this for non-anesthet. Again, familiarity with the reversal medication is important for sedation provider. It is important to monitor patients who have received reversal agents for an extended period of time due to the risk of resedation again after the reversal agents wears off. If we are giving sedatives and there is delayed recovery, we are now pushed to give reversal. Take care that the reversal medication shorter than the sedative effect itself. So the patient may recover and go to sedation again, relapse again. If you are giving this medication, reversal medications, keep the patient on your in front of you and give the patient chance for at least 1 to 2 hours under close monitoring. We are using flumazenil as antidote for midazolam and benzodiazepines. We are using naloxone for opioid antagonists. Actually, flumazenil, if given, it may lead to seizures. Naloxone also, if given, it needs lead to ischemic heart attack or arrhythmia or hypertension because it abolish all the analgesic effect of opioids. Special considerations for various off-site locations. For example, radiology department, non-movable equipment, fixed CR can impede the access to the patient. An MRI scanner was additional consideration as standard rescue equipment cannot be taken to the zone, into zone four of the scanner. In a critical situation, the patient must be removed from the scanner zone and to the outside to give the resuscitative effort. Okay, but she also should be in mind during planning for sedation. In radiation oncology, there is also often a shared location, so it is important to have separate pediatric specific monitors, supplies, and equipment. There need to be a method for visualization and monitoring the patient while patient is receiving radiation. Cameras to visualize the patient and monitors during the radiation session are essential. Oncology procedures, if sedation is frequently performed in these areas, should be fully stocked with pediatric sedation cart and the emergency medications. With equipment and medication is necessary, a plan should also be made for recovery of these patients. Many hospital units have a nurse to patient, one nurse for patient recovery, which is inadequate to observe patient recovery from sedation. So they receive more than mild sedation. Child life specialist can be particularly useful in these areas, potentially avoiding the need for sedation. Non-hospital locations like dental office and the standalone imaging centers are limited in their ability to have extra help. And this is also should be in consideration of choice of patients. So sedation provider in this area should have their abilities and the skills to give the BLS. As regards pediatric airway equipment, medications, monitors, and IV access supplies must be present and evaluated routinely. In the event of a major resuscitation, the team providing sedation must support the patient until the arrival of emergency medical service. What about recovery? Recovery area should be equipped with oxygen, suction, emergency airway equipment, emergency medications, including reversal and cool medications should also easily accessible. Pulse oximetry, blood pressure, heart rate, and this should be monitored routinely for deeply sedated patients. Monitoring should be continued until the patient is easily aroused, has a patent away with recovery of reflexes, and is hemodynamically stable. For X have a risk of apnea after receiving sedation medication. And the consideration should be given to overnight admission and monitoring. Also, this should be done and practiced by an assist. At discharge, the patient should be awake with normal vital signs for age, adequate control of nausea and vomiting and pain. Prior to discharge, the caregiver should be given a verbal and written instruction on the post-procedural care. Thank you for you, and happy to have any questions. After 5 minutes, we will start the next lecture. I am happy to have questions. أي حد بيمارس أعطاء معديات في البراكتس بتاعه أو بيشوف دون في شغله وفي اي سؤال بحابب يستفسر عنه او يساله احنا طبعا هيبقى ان شاء الله في توك بعد المحاضره الجايه ان شاء الله قبل نهايه الكورس منتظر منكم التفاعل لان بعد الكورس ده محتاجين اكيد كلنا في اسئله كتير بنشوفها، حاجات كتير، سيناريوهات كتير بنشوفها وبنقابلها، ومحتاجين استفسار عنها او راي عنها، ممكن يعني نتبادل مع بعض الخبرات ونستفيد من بعض كلنا يعني. وخصوصا دون بيبقى براكتس، ممكن يبقى ديلي براكتس يعني، واهم حاجه فيه السيفتي. فيا ريت نستفيد كلنا من الفرصه دي، ونحاول نبقى في دسكشن مفتوحه مع بعض، ولو في حاجه دلوقتي نقدر نتناقش فيها مع بعض. What is the best medication for pediatric? Again, قلنا ميدازولام and fentanyl according to age and according to situation. لو ال procedure is painful، إذا هيعمل حاجة فيها ألم، هنبقى نحط الفنتانيل قبل الميدازولام. إذا الموضوع ما فيه ألم، يبقى يستحسن الميدازولام. الدوز بير كي جي، وندي وقت للدوز إن هي تاخد وقتها تشتغل. في أي سؤال تاني؟ ابدأ المحاضرة. بسم الله. speaking about criteria for recovery and discharge as per American Society of Anesthesiology. صوت واضح، الشاشة واضحة. What is about the post sedation care? A standard post-sedation care refers to those activities undertaken to manage the patients after completion of a procedure and the concomitant primary anesthesia. Purpose of the guidelines for post-anesthesia care, these guidelines apply to patients of all ages who have just received general anesthesia, regional anesthesia, or moderate to deep sedation. To improve the post anesthesia care outcome for patients who have just have procedural sedation and analgesia, also to optimize the sedation and the analgesia care, providing recommendations for patient assessment, monitoring, and the management with the goal of optimizing patient safety. Our target always safety. What is the goals? Focus on the perioperative management of patients, reducing postoperative adverse events, providing a uniform assessment of recovery, improving post-anesthetic quality of life, streamlining postoperative care and discharge criteria. When we start the post-anesthesia care, actually we start the post-anesthesia care from the pre-anesthesia assessment. It started pre-procedural, not post-procedural, as recommended by the American Society of Anesthesiology guidelines. The outcome of post-anesthesia care actually depends on the pre-anesthesia assessment, the intra-anesthesia sedation, intra-sedation بروسيدر سيديشن مانجمنت ذيس ويل افكت شور افكت ذا بوست انستيزيا اوت كوم اور بوست سيديشن اوت كوم. سو اوبتيمم سيلكشن of assessment of the patient, optimum selection of medication and the policy and the construction of a plan, this will affect, sure affect the post-anesthesia outcome. What about the patient assessment and monitoring as guided by American Society of Anesthesiology? Perioperative and post-anesthetic management of the patients includes periodic assessment and monitoring of respiratory function, cardiovascular function, neuromuscular function, all systems, mental status, temperature, vital signs, pain, nausea and vomiting, fluid assessment, urine output and voiding for drainage and bleeding. So when we assess the patient during the post anesthesia in the recovery area, we should assess the vital data, we should assess the consciousness, motor power, hemodynamic stability, excessive pain or no, level of pain if there is any pain, nausea and vomiting, if there is any fluid losses, like bleeding, like shifting of fluid shift, for example, or perfusion status by guided by urine, for example, urine output voiding and the capillary refill time and hemodynamics. Periodic assessment of airway patency, respiratory rate, and oxygen saturation should be done during emergence and recovery. Particular attention should be given to monitoring oxygenation and ventilation. Routine monitoring of pulse and blood pressure should be done during emergence and recovery again. Don't forget the clinical assessment. We not only depend on the monitors and the machines, we should have a look and our clinical experience and sense for the patient. Patient color, pattern of breathing, response of the patient during communication, all this should be noticed. What is the recommendations? Our recommendation about assessment of neuromuscular function should be performed during emergence and recovery for patients who have received non-debilitating neuromuscular blocking agents or who have medical conditions associated with neuromuscular dysfunction. Mental status should be periodically assessed during emergence and recovery. Patient temperature should be periodically assessed during emergence and recovery also. Pain should be assessed and monitored, and if there is excessive pain more than 4 by visual analog scale, we should intervene. Again, we should look for nausea and vomiting and manage according to policies. Assess the hydration, etc. should be assessed in the post-anesthesia care unit and managed accordingly. Certain procedures involving significant loss of blood or fluids may require additional fluid management. Take care of the drains if there is any drain after the procedure. Assessment and also the consider the concealed bleeding. If there is any, for example, biopsies, ultrasound guided or CT guided or whatever biopsies, there may be major vessel injuries, there is maybe bleeding from the organ. All this should be in mind. Keep in mind. Assessment of urine output and urinary voiding should be done on a case-by-case basis for selected cases, patients, or selected procedures during emergence and recovery. Also, assessment of drainage and bleeding, as we mentioned before. How to give prophylaxis and treatment of nausea and vomiting? As Dr. Rawah said, nausea and vomiting may have many causes, may be drug-induced, may be related to the procedure itself. Okay, maybe the patient, this is the patient himself, his response to the anesthesia or stress by nausea and vomiting. So we have should have a pharmacological and a non-pharmacological measures. Non-pharmacological measures like good hydration, psychological support also, and the explanation of the patient, what is the expectations. Medications like antihistaminics, anti-serotonergic, tranquilizers, or neuroleptics, metoclopramide, and dexamethasone. Actually, metoclopramide have a narrow therapeutic index for safety in pediatrics. Don't forget, we administer supplemental oxygen during transportation or in the recovery area. Should be done for patient at risk of hypoxia and or every patient. Normothermia is important. Should be a goal during emergence and recovery also. When available, forced airway warming system should be used for treating hypothermia. Mibridine is not recommended actually. May be used for shivering, but is not recommended as a routine use. Antagonism of the effect of sedative, analgesic, and neuromuscular blocking agents. Actually, in sedation course, We are not using neuromuscular blocking drugs, but antagonism of benzodiazepines, which is specific antagonism like flumazenil, should be available whenever benzodiazepines are administered, shouldn't be used routinely, but may be administered to antagonize respiratory depression and sedation in high doses or unexpected delayed recovery. Specific antagonists should be available whenever opioids are administered, like naloxone, shouldn't be used routinely, but may be administered to antagonize respiratory depression in selected patients, because there is some harm from this antagonist or reversal medication. You reverse all the effect of opioids like analgesia, patient will be suffering from pain for opposite to extremities. Also for benzodiazepines, if you are revising by the flumazenil, it may give the patient risk to develop seizures. After pharmacological antagonist, patient should be observed long enough to ensure that the cardiac respiratory depression doesn't reoccur again, because we say mentioned many times that the reversal drug have a shorter duration of action than the sedative drug. The task force remind practitioners that acute antagonism of the effect of fluids may result in a pain, hypertension, tachycardia, or pulmonary edema. Specific antagonists should be administered for reversal of residual neuromuscular blockade when indicated, and actually we are not using neuromuscular blockade in this course. What is the protocol for discharge? The routine requirement for urination before discharge shouldn't be a part of the discharge protocol and may only be necessary for selected patients. Okay. The requirement of drinking clear fluids shouldn't be also a part of the discharge protocol and may only be necessary for selected patients. For example, diabetic patient, he should have full recovered and void easily and drink freely. In old age patient with some renal impairment, you should be sure that he has voiding, because it may be at risk of acute kidney injury post the procedure. You should be able that his patient good hydrated, also in pediatrics. As part of the recovery discharge protocol, all patients should be required to have a responsible individual accompany them home. We cannot discharge a patient alone to home. Patients should be observed until they are no longer at increased risk for cardiorespiratory depression. A mandatory minimum stay shouldn't be required. Discharge criteria should be designed to minimize the risk of central nervous system cardiorespiratory depression after discharge. Actually, we should have a plan for safety of the patient before discharge and after discharge. As Dr. Rabah said in this last lecture, we are judging the patient for discharge by the modified Albert score. It is divided from five components: activity, which is muscular power, respiration, circulation, consciousness, oxygen saturation. Every item of this have score from 0 up to 2. Total score should be at least 9 from 10 or 10 from 10. If the score less than 9, patient cannot be discharged at all. And actually, for procedure sedation, if we shift patient to home, it's recommended to be 10 from 10. How to calculate Albert score? Albert score is measured by evaluating these 5 criteria, including the individual's activity, respiration, circulation, consciousness, and oxygen saturation. A score of 0, 1, or 2 is given for each category, 2 representing the ideal condition. For example, the activity parameter is based on the ability to move extremities voluntarily or on command and purposefully. A score of 2 given for moving all 4 extremities, a score of 1 for moving only 2 extremities, 0 if there is no any movement. For respiration, individual is given 2 points when being able to breathe deeply, cough freely without any tachycardia or tachypnea, without any hypopnea, without any noisy breathing. If there is a respiratory effort, but breathing is limited, it is a score of 1. If there is apnea at all, the patient is considered as 0. Also, if the tachypnea is more than 30, it's called as like 0. Any respiratory extremity of the respiratory stress, either by tachypnea or apnea, it is 0. Tachypnea more than 30. If the respiratory rate more than less than 30, but is higher than the usual, which is up to 18 in adults, this is not accepted score of 1. Dyspnea, always there is a problem. There is no benign dyspnea. For circulation, score is based on a systemic blood pressure values combined to the pre-anesthetic level. We should compare the level with the pre-anesthesia level for the heart rate, for the mean arterial blood pressure or systolic blood pressure. We accept a range of variability from 0 to 20% from baseline. if there is a change either above or minus. For example, the heart rate, if the heart rate starting, we are starting by heart rate 80, it's accepted to be in range from 90 to 70. Okay? If the range of the heart rate more than 100 and less than 60, for example, and the rate is in change from 20% to 40% from the baseline, this is considered stage level one. If there is extremes in the heart rate or blood pressure, this is zero. هقولها بالعربي معلش، بنتكلم بالنسبه للارتر سكور بنحسبه ازاي بالنسبه للسيركوليشن. احنا بنشوف الضغط والنبض بتاع المريض قبل العمليه او قبل ما ابدا سيديشن اصلا كان كام، وبنحاول نخلي المريض في رينج 20% فوق او تحت البيز لاين دون، يبقى كده ان اكسبتد بالنسبه لنا ياخد جريد سي 2. اذا التشينج او التغير في الهارت ريت او في الضغط بتاعه اللي هو السيستوليك او مين ارتر بريشر في رينج من 20 ل 50% يبقى فوق او تحت، يبقى انا كده دخلت في رينج واحد. لو العيان اكستريمز اكتر من كده فوق ال 50% من البيز لاين ده زيرو، يعني انا ما اقدرش اقبل ان عيان يخرج بالهارت ريت مثلا، ده هو داخل بهارت ريت 90 وانا اخرجه بهارت ريت 140، ده مش مقبول. مش بقول ان عيان داخل بهارت ريت 90 ويخرج بهارت ريت مثلا 50، ده برده مش مقبول. لكن برده على نفس القياس ما ينفعش عيان داخل بالضغط بتاعه 140 على 90 او المين ارتيريال بريشر بتاعه 110 اخرجه بالمين ارتيريال بريشر بتاعه مثلا 50 او 60، مش مقبول، وهكذا. فاحنا لينا رينج مقبول فيه التشنجز في الهيمودينامكس اللي هو من 20 من 20% فوق او تحت، من 20 ل 50% ده كده سكور 1، ده كده مش عيان سيف انه يخرج. زيرو يبقى في مشكله كبيره لازم نلاحظها، ممكن عيان سيفير بين يبقى تاكيكارديك بعنف، ممكن عيان يبقى عنده فلويد لوس اور بليدنج يبقى هايبوتنسيف بعنف، ده بيبقى العيان دخل في سيفير هايبرتنشن وهايبرتنشن هايبرتنسيف ايمرجنسي عشان هو اصلا ان كنترول هايبرتنشن. فطبعا العيان ده ما ينفعش يتحرك من يروح البيت بالمنظر ده ابدا. As regard consciousness, score of 2 for fully awake individuals, 1 for those arousable on calling then fall again to sleep, 0 for non-responsive patients. Scores are also given for oxygen saturation value and the method needed to achieve it. A score of 2 is given if an individual can maintain oxygen saturation of more than 92% on room air, while a score of 1 is assigned if supplemental oxygen is required to maintain more than 90% oxygen, and finally a score of 0 is given if saturation less than 90% even with supplemental oxygen, so we cannot discharge this patient at all. This is summary of table summary of the modified Albrecht score by every item and how to calculate. As we mentioned, we need at least 9 from 10 or 10 to 10.